Welcome back to Ucypher Naya Sport, Naya Superstars. After Game 3, the scores are Yakshas at 6 and Akramaks at 5. This is almost like history repeating itself, but the only difference is that the players are a lot more prepared. We are heading towards the last game of the day, the decider. It's time for DOTA 2.
Radiant's turn to ban. The Dire get a ban. Here's the Radiant ban. The Dire get a ban.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Ucypher continues with Akramaks taking on the Yakshas in the second round robin. I'm CloudX, with me is Vivek, and today we're in for a hell of a game as Yakshas, the table toppers, are taking on Akramaks, a squad that's found their stride off late.
Yeah, I mean, it's this would have been a game not worth too much attention because the Akramaks were looking rough in the last couple of games, but with the role switches, with what they've come anew with, their new strategy, it seems to be working Radiant's for them. I like the Aqua and pick. I like Kiko on the 5 position. Let's see if they can somehow pull through and beat, like you mentioned, those at the top of the table, the Yakshas.
Akramaks are going to start off with the Viper as their first pick. They've banned out the Legion, Venomancer, and the Undying here. Not sure what that Legion Commander ban was about. It's not very conventional to see a first ban Legion Commander. But Yakshas are going to go ahead and reprise with a pick on the Lich and the Faceless Void. Neither side dipping into the reserve time. They've come in with a plan and they're here to execute. Surprisingly enough, Medusa and Spectre have both been ignored in the first phase. I'm not seeing any bans just yet, but perhaps this is their time.
This is where they get banned, I presume. Yeah, Medusa gets banned.
I mean, the meta has been changing ever so subtly right from the start of this tournament. Sure, there was a patch change, but even since the time of the new patch, we've seen the Doom gain favor and now lose favor. We've seen the Tidehunter who suddenly come to the forefront. Medusa and Spectre are being left out to dry. And, well, most notably, it's the Doom that's just being left out altogether. Doom and the Nightstalker, for that matter.
I think Doom needs to be left out. There's not much for him to be in the game remaining and in the meta for any reason. But yeah, the Nightstalker exclusion is rather unusual. Yakshas can pick it up if they want to.
Yeah.
They still have room for it. The Akramaks, they're in a bit of a pickle. They're not sure whether we ban out the Spectre just yet, or do we let the Yakshas have the Spectre? I think you just play it safe, ban out the Spectre. If you aren't prepared to play against it, just ban it.
Yeah, ideally, I think, but I don't know. Do you think the Yakshas aren't prepared for this? Because Void's one of those that could pick up the Silver Edge if absolutely necessary. The break is going to work very well versus the Spectre. You've also got the Chronosphere for guaranteed lockdown, which works well with the Lich ult. You know, if at all he pops the Haunt and there's a Haunt illusion within the Chronosphere, that's a free Chain Frost bounce as well. It makes sense that Yakshas picks up that Void and ignores the Spectre in the draft.
I was hinting that the Akramaks just ban out the Spectre.
Oh, I don't think the Akramaks have the space for a Spectre. I mean, the Yakshas have the space for a Spectre, to be honest. It's a little greedy when you run Faceless Void and the Spectre on the same draft. But Akramaks will go with the Winter Wyvern. This is a really neat way to deal with the Void in the Chronosphere. Either you can just drop the Winter's Curse on the Void and disable him, or you can pop the Cold Embrace inside of the Chrono and Void basically hits him like a little girl. Akramaks, they've now got two flying heroes, so to speak, on their side. Do they supplement this with a Batrider pick? Because it seems like they're still lacking an offlaner. And, you know, jokes aside about them having wings, I think the Batrider does make sense here for them.
Yeah, they could pick up the Batrider. I mean, the Legion's been banned out, Silencer's out of the pool. I don't see Yakshas having the space to pick up the Oracle, so this wouldn't be too bad a game for the Batrider.
Mm-hmm. It's also unlikely that they're going to go with the Venge, because I'd expect this to be an offlane Void and a 4-position Sand King, in which case the Venge just doesn't fit the bill, unless you're going to go with the 1-position Venge, which really isn't the ideal way to deal with the Batrider lassoing you in. They're going to go with the Bristleback on the side of Akramaks. This is still beatable. The brake mechanic would hold a lot of value versus both the Bristle as well as the Viper, which is all the more of a reason for Faceless Void to pick up the Silver Edge this game.
10 seconds.
Turn to back.
Yep.
Arc Warden.
What? The Yakshas pick up the Arc Warden.
Okay, they're going to give them a taste of their own medicine. And again, that's another Silver Edge carrier towards the late game stage.
Uh-huh.
So outside over the cup of tea again, I did have a conversation with Punk, and he did mention that they like running the Arc Warden themselves. Yeah. So this doesn't come as too much of a surprise, to be honest.
Five seconds remaining.
The neat little synergy that comes out with the Arc Warden and the Faceless Void, the Chronosphere, and of course Arc Warden standing far behind and banging away with the Dragonlance bonus range. It makes sense. But it also means that the Void can't play greedy this game, because we all know how Arc Warden works. He needs that early farm to go by himself. He needs that space to go farming, go split pushing, and get his early items online, without which he's really not as effective as he'd like to be. In that case, the Void can't afford to go for luxury items like a Battle Fury. The Void has to be fighting every time the Chronosphere is back online. To do that, he's going to need Lich to hit an early level 6 as well. So a lot's riding on Yakshas to get their early game in place. But the problem is Akramaks has a super strong lineup in the early game stages. Bristleback is fantastic in his own lane. Viper is just, I mean, he's the alpha male of this draft at the moment. There's no one that can zone out a Viper in the laning stage.
Dire's turn to pick.
There's also the fact that the early game Arc Warden does rely on magic damage as his source of damage output. Viper's fantastic versus that with the way the corrosive skin works. And I'd also expect Bristleback to get a pipe this game, if not in the early stages. Eventually he's going to pick up one. Pipe is going to be fantastic versus the Lich, the Sand King, and the Arc Warden for that matter. The way Yakshas could run their draft successfully here would be to pick up a ranged core for the middle lane, or if they're running this Arc Warden on the mid, they want to pick a tempo control slash space creating core. I like the Slark in that department.
Yeah, I was just going to suggest the exact same thing. Pick up the Slark.
The Slark and the OD, I'd say these are my two favorite picks for Yakshas in this game. More so the Slark than the OD, because, I mean, OD is still a fair bit greedy and he might need some room to work with. But again, the problem is the Slark and the Void don't really have synergy.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you could just run this as a safe lane Arc Ward and then pick up something like a Queen of Pain for the mid as well. Venomancer still in... No, never mind. Venomancer has been banned out.
Yeah, I'm leaning more towards a safe lane Arc Warden and something like a Queen of Pain, or heck, even a Lina in the mid lane.
Yeah, Queen of Pain, Puck would have been my priority picks, but okay, they're going to go with the Razor pick.
This is a nice pick,
this
actually.
This is new and it's actually very nice.
It's
going to
be good in lane versus the Bristleback.
I think it's going to be a mid Razor though, versus the Viper. And again, that's a good lane.
Yeah, you're right. It's going to be a mid Razor. So they're putting the Arc Warden in the safe lane. So I'd actually like to see Akramaks just run the Bristleback in the safe lane versus the Void. It's a matchup that I think the Bristleback can win, because although you might be able to time walk the Quill Spray damage at a certain point, the Quill Spray stacks are still going to be upon you. So it's going to be hard for you to come back into the lane. And there's no way you stand around the Bristleback and win a lane versus the Bristleback. If, however, this Bristleback does go to the off lane, then it's going to be a really hard time for him. Sand King, Razor, Lich, they will be able to kill him early on and just set the tempo of the lane from there on. Akramaks are looking for a one position.
What's their one position option here?
So they're looking for a Dream Hero, right? Dream played the Arc Warden last time around. It's a good one position here.
Do you think the Anti-Mage fits the bill, or is that too greedy? I don't see the team fight on the side of Akramaks. There's a Winter's Curse which has, well, it disables a hero and it could delete a hero in the late game stages, but it's not really locked down because your teammates can't do anything while you're in it. And the Earth Spirit is not the most reliable way to start a fight either. So I'm not sure what Akramaks' game plan is here. The Bristleback pick, it would have been nice in any other scenario, but this is one where they needed the Batrider. Instead, they're going to go with the Drow Ranger as their final pick. Their pushing potential is huge, I'm not going to contest that at all. Their physical DPS is massive as well. But their team fight seems a bit lackluster. And that might come back to hurt them when you're going up against something like the Void with the Chronosphere and the Lich to follow it up.
Mm-hmm.
Just those two heroes can be so devastating to the entirety of Akramaks. Drow is also one of those heroes that likes to stay back and, you know, dish out damage from the backlines. Void's fantastic at closing the gap with the Time Walk. Razor's got enough mobility and movement speed to run up to the drow and start stealing damage. If he doesn't do that, he's got the Bristleback, who's almost always going to be on the front lines to give him damage as well. And you can never forget the Sand King with the Blink and the Burrow Strike to get himself upon Dream to start things on his terms. It looks like Yakshas has the better draft on paper. Akramaks has the better push on paper, but I fear for Akramaks if this game goes on for too long. Razor and the Arc Warden seem like the prime heroes to take the fight to them in the mid and late game stages.
Yeah, on paper it appears that the Yakshas are indeed the side with the stronger team fight here. They've gone for a lineup that can push on the side of the Akramaks. The intention is clear. They want Wiper to have a good time in the lane versus the Razor. I'm not sold on the idea that he's going to be winning the lane just because of the draw order. But let's see if Make Believe can make it happen this time around.
So they're running Akrid on the Razor, so he's going safe lane, and Arc Warden is indeed going to go towards the middle lane. I'd probably favor running the Razor at the middle lane and then Arc Warden towards the safe lane, but I guess the drawback on the Yaksha squad is Akrid most likely doesn't play the Arc Warden, which is why even though they pick the Razor, they can't quite run him on the middle lane. But, you know, that said, Razor's not too shabby versus the Bristle in the laning stage either. Look at what they're doing though.
Yeah.
You see a Radiant Smoke as they move into the jungle to try and contest the Bounty Rune. They're not going to find anyone so far, but they're thinking of dropping down some offensive Observer wards. Kiko still has the wards, the Obs and the Sentry sitting upon him. Razor, he's not walked down to the rune just yet, but he's not in the most safe position either.
I think he's done for. Arctic Burn. Yeah, Akrid is pretty much gone. The Rolling Boulder is going to whip. Kiko needs the Arctic Burn. He's popped it early, but Akrid reaches the safety of his tier 1.
Alright, they're going to get the Bounty Rune then. No contest coming out from the Razor, but on the other side, it looks like they're going to take over both the Bounty Runes as well. So this is a bit of a wasted effort coming out from Akramaks. Now they're going to have to make the long trek back to their respective lanes. We're seeing the middle lane as TP out as always, but Blue Frog, unless he's planning to harass mid right from level 1, he's going to have to make the long trek all the way back to the bottom lane alongside that Winter Wyvern as well. This also means that Dream has been left alone for the first creep wave. If VP recognizes this, he could just go for a level 1 kill on the draw.
Yeah, they are positioning aggressively across the bottom lane. Bristleback.
Oh, look at this though, VP.
Oh, mid lane, they've gone in with the Rolling Boulder. Appa, he's not committed his skill point. It's going to be some early damage, but they could turn this around with the Flux if they want to.
He hasn't put a skill yet, like you said. The spark rate might have been nicer. VP is also spotting out Kiko moving towards the bottom side of the map. So perhaps he could go in for Blue Frog, who's going to walk past him as well. Now VP is just hiding in the trees. He's going to dodge this rotation coming out from Blue Frog. This is actually really smart, because now he's going to come in from a position where the Viper would least expect him to come from behind. I mean, they'd have absolutely no clue that VP was here.
Yeah, VP could just run right in.
Oh, now they ping him though. Look at Blue Frog.
Blue Frog sees him. And VP's put the point into Burrow Strike. That's a level 1 Burrow Strike. He's could be turned upon. Yeah, he's drawn tower aggro. Blue Frog trying to cotton him off. The Rolling Boulder, well, it's a bit of a white ball and VP's just going to run away.
Yeah, VP's got the boots and Blue Frog doesn't, so he's not going to catch up to him that easily. Meanwhile, top lane's turning out to be quite a bother for Max. He's having all of his damage stolen versus this Razor, who's CSing like a boss in the lane. He's also got the magic wand online, so Max has to be judicious about the way he spams those quill sprays. Got two stacks upon Akrid right now, but I think the smarter choice for Max would be to wait till he gets one more level before going all in on Akrid. Because right now he's just giving him two free magic wand charges, which could be the difference between life and death for him.
I'll take your arms for the dead.
Punk, so far so good for him. He's managed to deny a creep with the sacrifice and also picks up two bounty runes now on the top half of the map. That's going to really accelerate his levels. With the Frost Blast available, they might even consider going for a kill on Max if Akrid's put that second point. Yeah, he's got it in the Static Link. He's already stolen away a good 73 damage from him.
Max sees him though with the Observer.
Look at the bottom lane though. Blue Frog's in trouble himself. VP with the Burst Strike coming in. Kiko has that Splinter Blast, but what's the use? He's not going to be able to offer any defense as VP will get First Blood. Khalnayak though, takes a bit of a beating on his way back towards lane. Well, Dream joins the party as well. up top, this could be Max's death as well.
Yeah, they've got the static link. It's a lot of damage upon the Razor. 53 plus 100 and still counting. The plasma field, another auto attack. Max secures the kill. So Max has to make a small adjustment, and it's not such a big adjustment. In fact, all he has to do is TP out in such scenarios.
Yeah, I'm not sure. Okay, use the TP to come in now. So again, he's fairly susceptible to active.
Yeah, they just need to go again. There's nothing this Blisterback can do.
2 seconds till the static link is online, and yeah, here we go.
This isn't going to be a kill, and yeah, Akrid realizes that.
So Appa's queued up the Ring of Aquila first, then the Midas. They need to offer some more protection for him, because the Viper is kind of stomping all over him in the lane now. He's at 14 and 8 versus 9 and 5 on that Arc Ward, and every poison attack hit hurts like a... Well, let's censor that for now. Appa. I wonder if he's going to call out a bottle just for the sustenance.
I was just wondering, what do you really do if you're not coordinating in this matchup? I mean, the best you can hope for is that somebody ganks the Viper. And it seems as if VP is just going to do just that. Moves across the mid lane, land one bow strike, Appa. Trying to close the gap. He's got Flux, 2 points in it, and the Spark Rate.
This is
now, make believe if he had a TP, he could TP out. He pops the Fairy Fire, but Appa just has too much damage. Make believe didn't bother turning back and relying on the Earth Spirit to come in time, and ends up paying with his life there.
Yes, 2 points in Flux, 2 points
but
in Spark.
But Appa needs to be careful. Once again, Blue Frog missing the Rolling Boulder.
This is very uncharacteristic of Blue Frog. He's been on point with his previous games on those rotating supports, but this time around, he's missed pretty much 3 out of 3 rolling boulders. Meanwhile, bottom, when the supports leave Dream like this, Punk just immediately smells blood in the water and goes for him. Unfortunately, Khalnayak hasn't been blessed by RNG. He didn't go to the mandir today, and Time Lock will not connect. VP, 4 Tranquil Boots complete now on this Sand King. Even drops an Observer Ward in the middle lane to watch make-believe shenanigans. We've got a Sentry on the opposite side as well.
Damn, 2 Observer Wards in the mid lane.
This is, I mean, it's just as the first Observer Ward times out, yeah. So it makes sense.
And even gets one planted for the Bristleback. So he's trying to keep shuffling between top and mid and offer as much assistance as possible.
And he hasn't been spotted by a ward this time either. But he'll be spotted by Max as he walks back.
The good news, I mean, there's a lot of good news for the Yakshas. But one of them is that Khalnayak is doing really well in his offlane compared to the Bristleback. The other issue is that Droz just missing last hits.
Look at what VP is doing though. He's just applying pressure here on Max. If Akrid runs up to him and starts stealing damage, I'm fairly certain they can score this kill on Max with VP tanking up a couple of hits under the tower perhaps. In fact, he might not even have to. He can just take the path around the trees here. But yeah, he's chosen to just go back all the way. Picking up his own bounty rune first. Seems like the better idea. But Kiko, what's he doing on the bottom lane? Pops an Arctic Burn and goes to work on Khalnayak again. They're desperately struggling to get these bounty runes. Blue Frog comes in just with the Rolling Boulder. No Boulder Smash to follow up there. Khalnayak. Guess he didn't get the bounty rune after all. It was Kiko that picked it up. TP though.
Yeah,
back up
the Radiant Observer timed out. Max is pretty much done for. He could wait for the Butter Strike and then TP out, but he doesn't have a TP, and Akrid just hits like a truck.
Yep. He doesn't even need to pop his 17 Wand charges. He has a salve to work with. And his Ring of Aquila will be complete for the mana regeneration. Fantastic stuff coming out on this top lane. Max, I think it's time for him to go into the jungle.
Oh, Spark Raid does manage to catch out Blue Frog as well as Kiko there. Kiko and Blue Frog were really doing some work in the previous game, but this time around they've been rather quiet.
This is the problem we spoke about in the draft as well. They don't have any reliable lockdown at all in this game. Blue Frog can't, I mean, you can't really rely on Blue Frog to always connect those rolling boulders, especially if there's vision upon him. It's fairly easy to dodge. Appa though, now he gets slowed by the Splinter Blast. They're walking forward for the poison attack as well, but he's under his tower. Make believe has to be super careful about going in on him.
Yeah, the only good news for the Akramaks is that they're winning the mid lane. That's about it.
I don't know if I'd count this a win, to be honest. Viper's at 31, Arc Warden's at 22. Arc Warden should have been shut down almost entirely here. And he's making steady progress towards his Midas as well, so... I don't think I count this as a win at all for the Viper. VP though. He wants to use the Shrine, but realizes that he's got the Tranquil Boots instead. They're TPing out towards the bottom lane, at least the Winter Wyvern is, with Lufrong hanging about there as well. Khalnayok hasn't hit level 6 just yet, but Dream just got overzealous here and went to work. Never mind, they're gonna get the kill on Funk, and Khalnayok can't do much but sit and watch. He now jumps down towards the south side. Blue Frog gets the silence off with a geomagnetic grip. Khalnayok still taking a beating, gets silenced by the gust, but there's the Flux with the Spark Wraith and the Tempest Double doing some work as Dream goes down. Kiko's gonna follow up as well. Akramaks on the receiving end of those blows.
I mean, I understand what the Akramaks are hoping for. They were just hoping that the Lich and the Khalnayok Void wouldn't move, and then Blue Frog would finally connect one of his rolling boulders, which happened, and they managed to kill off the Lich. But Khalnayok got away, and the silence of the gust coming up from the draw wasn't quick to follow the geomagnetic grip, and Void survives, and Appa TP's in and gets a bunch of kills. Akred, he's bullying this Bristleback. A Bristleback with no farm is pretty much good for nothing, and make believe TP's in.
Akred's got 224 stolen
now,
damage.
Look at this, Akred, he's just gonna try and TP out, but make believe does have enough damage with the renewed poison attack, secures the kill. And Punk, who walked into lane with brown boots, will end up falling as well.
Make believe salvaging this game for his team. Akramaks not quite out of it just yet. That double kill's gonna give him a bit of a shot in the arm. He's catching up to the Razor in terms of net worth as well, so he's having a fairly good time here. Akrid just got a little too happy seeing the 224 stolen damage. He thought he might be able to turn for Make Believe, but Make Believe just spits Manikchand on him and finishes the job ASAP. That Viper Strike doing a fair bit of damage earlier on as well. You've also got to remember that Poison Attacks now got the buff from the old Nether Toxin too.
Yeah.
So if you're low on HP, that Poison Attack will rip your new one. Meanwhile, bottom, VP gets tagged with a Burrow Strike. Void's coming forward as well. The Geomagnetic Grip Silence kicks him as well. As Khalnayok smacks the Boulder Smash that just misses the wickets. VP slowed down, but healthy enough to walk away. But elsewhere, Appa puts a full stop to Make Believe Snowball with a solo kill.
Akramaks,
what's that courier doing? Okay, that's a dead giveaway about where VP's standing. Look at top lane though. Akrid is back to his old no good deeds again. Max, you can't go diving a tier 1 under a Razor. What are you thinking?
This is really stubborn. This is reminiscent of Devil Jimbachi's Batrider.
He's 0-4-1. Time and again, he's just going out there overestimating his hero's capabilities. It's time to go into the jungle, man. You know that the Razor's a hero that works exceedingly well versus the Bristleback. It's amateur to go dying to him again and again like this.
Also, what are your thoughts on Dream's skill build on the Drow Ranger?
Oh, really? Putting points into the gust instead of the precision aura?
I don't know, isn't that... they're going in on Khalnayok, they've got a second too late on the gust. But yeah, why? I'm not really sure. Why 2 points in the frost arrows and then 2 points in the gust?
Yeah, beats the hell out of me. I mean, I'd have loved to see him max out the precision aura to help his Viper do most of the damage
exactly.
This game. Make believe he's gonna have to TP in towards the bottom lane. He's actually queuing up a Veil of Discord this game for himself.
Mm-hmm.
I guess it works well with Blue Frog in the vicinity as well, but yeah, I don't know. That's just incentivizing them to get BKBs earlier on. Yasha, nearly complete on Akrid. Not only is he hitting like a truck, he's also very mobile now. Also got that 1 point in the unstable current.
Fortification can save them. Once again, another perfect scan coming up from the dive. They caught Blue Frog last time around and they caught him again. Bottom lane though, Dream, he's in a bit of trouble. Khalnayok has the Chronosphere in a bit. He's silent, but it won't last for long. He could go in. Blue Frog with a clutch geomagnetic grip. The Boulder Smash misses like it always does.
What are you doing, Dream?
And elsewhere, the Winter Wyvern falls. Akrid is going ham. He wants Max in the top lane. He has the range. He gets the kill. Make that a double. Khalnayok, though, dropping low. Make believe giving chase. The Viper Strike committed. Blue Frog attempts another rolling boulder, but it's just been attempt after attempt. The Boulder Smash does connect. Khalnayok has the time walk in a bit. His TP is in his backpack, so he doesn't have that option. He's running towards the enemy shrine, and Blue Frog tags
nice
it,
silence.
Gets the geomagnetic grip, and gets the kill.
That was a wild goose chase that they went on, but Appa, he's managed to take a tier 1 tower at the middle lane in the meanwhile. So space was created, the Chronosphere wasn't committed, a Viper rotation was forced out as well, but the death on Khalnayok could come back to hurt him later, because that's going to be the Veil almost finished up on Make Believe. And while I'm not entirely in agreement with this item choice, it's still a bit of a power spike coming out for them. Honestly, I'd have liked to see a Dragon Lance coming out on this Viper. The Veil, while it does add a little bit of armor to him, it's not doing too much in terms of effective HP, given that there's magic damage on the other side. This is probably going to hurt him a lot more than he realizes.
So, I mean, the idea of the Veil, from what I've understood, is that Midwan builds it on his Viper and takes the 8% spell lifesteal talent. So, you're getting more, you're doing more damage from a corrosive skin. I'm going to get back to that because Max...
Nothing to see here, Max just dies again.
Yeah, Max just doing Max things here. But yeah, make believe trying to find a kill. He does have the Viper Strike, doesn't have the movement speed, and actually just runs away. But yeah, the whole point of the Veil is to take that 8% spell life
bottom,
talent.
Bottom, look at what's happening.
Life stealing. VP and Kalnag, they're trying to farm this droll, just like how they've been farming the Visser back on the top half of the map. They commit the Chain Frog, the Caustic is there, Kalnag gets the last hit, commits the Chronosphere.
Why?
Blue Frog caught in it. Is there enough damage? Yes, there is. Akramaks coming out. Blue Frog needs to get a Boulder Smash or a Rolling Boulder away, but it looks like we won. 13 minutes in, 14-4 is the score. The Akramaks in serious trouble in the early game.
I was a little skeptical about that Chronosphere coming out from Kalnayak, but then VP just showed up with a Blink Dagger to finish the job and help with the Butter Strike. So.
So VP picked up his Blink Dagger sometime around Viper getting his Veil. Okay, no, Viper's still not got
his Veil. Viper still not got his Veil, so the four position sank
him. VP pick up his Blink Dagger at the 12-minute mark.
That's a tier 1 tower in favor of Yakshas as well. They'll continue their dominating streak through this early game stage as well now. Appa, how's he looking in terms of farm? His Midas is complete. He's got an extra Glove of Ace for good measure, which should be converted into the Maelstrom that's flying out to him shortly as well. Boots of Travels next, I hope. Nope, he's got the Shadow Blade queued up.
Probably wants the Halberd and wants to fight. Probably wants the Silver Edge, excuse me, and wants to fight often. Doesn't feel the need to rat just yet.
I don't know, I think not just the rat, it's just a lot more efficient to farm.
Yeah, you can just farm a lot faster, I agree.
But he's also leveling up like an absolute beast here. He's now up to level 12, keeping pace with Akrid, who's 6-1-2 with the Sanjin Yasha on that Razor.
Yeah,
this is getting ridiculous. He fed the Razor way too much, and now... Unfortunately, Max has nothing. He's not tanky at all in this game. He's got 2 points in the Bristleback. He's got just the Hood coming out soon. That really is not an answer to the physical DPS coming out from the rest of Razor, as well as, well, Arc Warden to a certain extent. How's the Void looking? Vlad's to augment the damage output again. So some synergetic items coming out from each of them. But we're going to see a smoke attempt here coming out from Akramaks.
He's going to break the smoke now. They've got to cancel his Blink, they don't. He pops the Sandstorm, they have detection. Max trying to give chase here. VP needs to be careful. Can Kiko keep him controlled with the Arctic Burn? But that's all the control they have. Kalnayak hanging around, no Chronosphere. They're going to kill a Sand King if nothing else. And that's still a killing spree.
Yeah. The smoke does get dispelled, but Kalnayak, he was trying to be efficient over there. While the Sand King was busy dying, he was still farming the creep wave at the bottom lane before he moves to pick up a TP. Yeah. This won't be costly for him at all. In fact, they could consider turning this around. They have the Chain Frost.
Monk is coming in with the Chain Frost. Big believes here. He's picked up the Veil.
Kiko's got a Winter's Curse though, so they have to be careful about the way they use their Chronosphere.
Okay, Arc Warden's TP then as well. If they do manage to catch Appa and that Winter's Curse, it could do a lot of harm to his own teammates.
They're just clumping up for a Chronosphere. This is some horrendous position coming out from them. Max will walk forward and reveal Kalnayak's position, so it's not going to be an efficient initiation for him just yet. He's thinking of going forward, walks forward, doesn't jump forward with
the Boulder Smash is there. He needs to hold on, get the Chain Ignited Drift. He didn't bother. There's a battle elsewhere. VP goes in, the epicenter is huge. Lich manages to fall. They're focusing Viper, they'll get the kill. There's the Winter's Curse. Akrid. Well, he jumps out a couple of hits onto the Sand King, but nothing serious. Kalnayak getting the Geomagnetic Grip. The Magnetize as well. Blue Frog is hoping to get the kill and run away. But Kalnayak with the Chronosphere manages to ensure the kill on the Earth Spit takes place and runs to his shrine. VP still giving chase a couple of stick charges. But
he's true on the Winter Bible.
He's showing a little bit of mercy today.
Just the Lich traded for three heroes on the side of Akramaks. They lose two of their cores, the Bristleback practically doing nothing at this point. He went on a wild goose chase behind Kalnayak, and sure, the Chronosphere didn't drop in time, but the epicenter more than compensated for that courtesy VP. They win a successful team fight. They can't take any objectives on the back of it, but they'll continue to farm. And Appa, with a double Midas, he's already picked up the Shadow Blade. 17 minutes in. He's at 9.2k net worth. And with a double Midas, despite him having a double Midas rather, Akrid is almost keeping pace as well at 9.1k net worth.
Yep.
That just goes to show you how much he's been fed in the early stages of this game.
So, if you were leading the side of the Akramaks right now, what would you be telling it to? Why did you put 2 points into Gust?
Do you want the honest answer or the caster-friendly answer?
The honest answer is let's think about League of Legends.
No, the honest answer is why you feed Bobo.
Which Bobo?
The real answer is...
Let's smoke, let's find pickups.
Let's just stick to our higher ground and contest Rosh when they decide to go for it eventually.
Okay.
Maybe that's the play they make and use their damage against him with the Winter's Curse. Kiko, I don't think there's ever been more responsibility on his shoulders here. Khalnayak. He's also finished up. An Aghanim? No, that's a Diffusion? Oh, Yasha, sorry. Well, Akrid's finished up an Aghanim Scepter for himself. Oh, I don't know if that's the best choice, to be honest.
They're having fun. I don't know if this is going to come back to earth.
That's going to come back to earth, I'm pretty certain. Unless they can end the game right away, this Aghanim Scepter would not seem like a great choice. I would have loved to see the Silver Edge on Akrid this game.
Yeah, I agree. I think he'll go back for it, hopefully. They've got Aegis, they've got a 13,000 net worth advantage. And Akramaks, they have smoked up. It's seems as if they hope to contest Roshan. Now, smack on the bird. Roshan's already been taken down. VV, Blix is
Look at how they're just clumping up.
Yeah. Kalag just, I mean, probably salivating in his mouth right now.
Counter smoke and Akrid is just running forward at full speed ahead.
Kiko flies away with the Arctic Burn. VP goes in, he's got the Blink Dagger, goes in with the Butter Strike. Quick Geomagnetic Grip, the Chain Frost committed. Kiko embraces himself and the Gust is there upon the Sand King. Have they got enough to bring him down? There's the Winter's Curse! Akrid kills his own four position. They managed to bring down the Sand King, but Arpa and his Tempest Double just pushing them all back while Khalnayak being controlled on the side. He drops the Chronosphere, it's on to two. Groping Focus, Akrid. Still no Ag Scepter, but he's taking a lot of damage and dishing it out by the loads. Viper just TP's right next to his own tier 3. I hope he caught that on camera for posterity. And Max is all by himself. They're chasing him down. He's a little tanky. Khalnayak's got to respect this. And yeah, he will. He's going to back off.
Akrid is busy in the base though. He's just gone and wiped the floor with the entirety of Akramaks. Killing three heroes under their own tier 3 tower. Inside their
he's
own...
He's hanging around. Kiko TP's in. Kiko has the Cold Embrace. Tell me he does. No, he doesn't! But Akrid's gonna drop and this is a waste of the ages. Punk is nearby, his team is in, but Appa's coming. Appa's got the Shadow Blade.
Okay, I'm sorry, but and while that may have looked exceedingly beneficial for the side of Yakshas, that was one of the stupidest team fights I've ever seen. You had Khalnayak just running around like a headless chicken, hoping to find a Chronosphere, but getting control time and again because he's just pump faking the Chronosphere a couple of times. Akrid goes forward, manages to kill three. His teammates decide not to back him up. Akrid says, to hell with you guys, I'm going to finish the job myself. And then they take no objectives after taking a successful team fight. I believe they had to sacrifice Punk for all of that, but they also sacrificed an Aegis, and that's the big deal here.
Okay. So the Ags upgrade to the Viper basically target structures, I didn't know that. You target structures as well.
To the Viper?
Apologies, to the Razor.
You confused me so much for a second there. I mean, I already knew that the Ags on the Razor does the structural damage. That's the reason why you pick it up. But
Kiko, they're going on the hunt. I guess he come in the Winter's Curse. Blue Frog, he hasn't connected
what
a
is
single
this?
Rolling boulder in a while. Possibly the entirety of this game.
It's not that they're popping bad smokes, it's just that they don't have a lineup to do anything with it.
Right.
You walk up onto the high ground like this, and if your smoke gets revealed, you have to rely on a blind rolling boulder smash, which is the most nonsense way to draft an initiation, honestly. Akrid though. With that Aghanim Scepter now able to target structures. I can't believe you didn't know this, Vivek. I'm so sorry, but I have to take a moment out here to give you hell for it. How the hell did you not know that Aghanim's on Razor hits buildings? This has been there for ages now.
What does Aghanim...
Who hired this man? VP. Gonna get silenced up on a cliff. Four staffs down, another boulder smash off the mark. The damage has been done. He got the D ward off and doesn't really care about the sentry up there. Radiant's middle tower has fallen. Well, Void's chrono is back online.
All tier 2 Wood Tower is taken down.
The next Aegis though. I mean, we know what happens at Ucypher. Even if you're in a commanding position like this, I mean, for God's sake, they have a 20,000 net worth lead. That Bristleback is picking up scraps off the floor at this point. But they're going to wait for the next Aegis before they go high ground. Why? Because they wasted the first Aegis completely needlessly.
Yeah.
This is the Ucypher meta. I mean, at this point, I still think they can just go and finish the game. One good Chronosphere that catches a couple of heroes and they finish the job. Mm-hmm. Heck, even if you catch just the Winter Wyvern and finish him off inside the Chronosphere, that's enough.
Catch the Winter Wyvern, bring him
back
from range.
The third smoke that's been popped on the Radiant side, and I believe it was spotted by a creep walking up onto the cliff. They've smoked, they're sitting in their base, while Appa is busy farming inside his own jungle near his shrine. Pretty much wasted all smokes on the side of Akramaks here.
So it's actually a bit hilarious. I was just walking around the set and a random crew member on the set just said this game will get up in 30 minutes. What is he saying?
His name Jon Snow by any chance?
Why did he say that? It was not the reference.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah, I don't know. He said 30 minutes and I was like, I don't think he knows about our preferences and our loves for ages here and Ucypher. But yeah, I just nodded my head and walked away. They're all hoping to get done early and get home. But yeah, his prediction is sort of starting to make sense. The question is, are the Yakshas going to wait and wait for Roshan number 2?
They're obviously going to wait for Roshan number 2, but now they're going to give Dream time to get more damage online. Viper's going to get a bit more tanky. He's going for the Blade Mail, by the way, so that's going to work in his favor.
Max has the Blade Mail as well.
Yeah, Max has the Blade Mail too. And now Razor can no longer do anything about it with his Aghanim Scepter, Eye of the Storm doing damage in the AoE. All they've got to do is Blade Mail and say, no, hit me, no, not me, hit me, and walk up to him.
Yeah.
Appa, just playing with his food here, drops down that magnetic field and...
Does make-believe not know that you need to walk into the magnetic field?
He should know. His team was the one that picked up the Arc Warden earlier on.
Yeah.
They've got the Silver Edge on Appa as well, but no HP to work with at the moment. Unfortunately, they didn't even take down a tier 3 after that last messy team fight, which means they can't go back and take the shrine. With the shrine still standing, there's an opportunity for the Akramaks to contest that next Roshan, which, I mean, it's painstakingly obvious that's what they're going to do on the side of Yakshas. But if you're on the Akramak squad, this has to be frustrating, right? You can see all three lanes being pushed in. All you can really do is stand on your high ground and farm complacently, waiting and waiting for the Aegis to respawn so that you can go and contest. And when a couple of heroes go off the map, you know that it's going to be Roshan time. Punk, yeah. Waiting in the pit, hoping that Roshan respawns under his skirt.
So you want to contest Roshan, but the best way to go and contest is, well, you TP in shrines and run the risk of TPing into vision, into enemy vision, or you have a smoke. But they've blown smoke after smoke in their base
exactly.
And not accomplished anything.
This is a mistake from the Yakshas because they've got no way to initiate a team fight on the side of Akramaks, right?
Yeah.
The game plan here is you simply walk down a lane and just right-click buildings from the low ground. Do some chip damage at the very least. And if someone gets overzealous or cocky on the side of Akramaks, you punish and take the fight. You don't just sit back and wait for the Aegis only to throw it away again. Appa is going to throw those illusions time and again. The Tempest doubles time and again, but they're not getting enough done. They're doing nothing at this point, in fact. Magnetic field dropped on the floor. Dream takes a bit of a beating. Wow, is Dream going to die? Okay then, that was too close.
I think all they need to do is throw Tempest double plus one. And when everybody focuses, maybe follow up with an Epicenter, then
really?
The Chrono. It's quite doable, right? You gotta wait. Your Tempest double is gonna give you an opportunity to secure a kill and force out a buyback if nothing else.
Well, we've got the time lock damage coming out on the Void. He's chosen to go for that instead of the 300 health talent, which seems to make sense. Appa. Clearing out a wave at mid, drops a flux, gets silenced, his Tempest double dies, and 180 gold goes over to the Viper. We've seen a lot of this at Ucypher. They're just not being stingy with their summon units. Visage, we've seen familiars failing left, right, and center. Now we're seeing Tempest doubles giving up so much gold and EXP to the enemies.
There's a certain generosity of heart here at Ucypher. I mean, what else explains Akrid going and giving away that extra life with his Aegis? They want a fair game. There's a sense of sportsmanship which rivals even the best in India here.
He's got an Assault Cuirass, they've got a Silver Edge on the Arc Warden, as we pointed out earlier. You've got Void picking up a Manta style. I genuinely don't know what they're waiting for, but
okay,
I guess
they've waited. Had enough. Just goes in.
Look, now they've waited this long, you might as well just wait for the damn Aegis.
I think, yeah, he's gonna respawn in a minute.
Bunk, he's been stunned at mid though.
Yeah, he's got a Glimmer Cape. Hopefully, Blue Frog. Or Kiko got detection? Yeah, Kiko has dust.
Akrid popped his ult. He did get some chip damage done in that tier 3 by the looks of it. Appa steeping himself up towards the top side. They want to split push all three lanes at the same time as his Tempest Double goes in towards the middle lane.
Dropping really low. They managed to kill him. God. Not sure what that was about. Blue Frog goes in. They've got detection for VP. The Magnetize upon him. Kalnag needs to turn and drop the Chrono Spear, but the Winter's Curse. It holds Kalnag in place. Make Believe takes a second, deciding who to focus. Kalnag goes in, but he's been silenced by the Geomagnetic Grip. Pops his Mandastal, wants to bring down Blue Frog. And with VP coming in, it looks like he will. Kalnag, he's got VP in the Chrono Spear, but more importantly, he has Make Believe in it as well. The Cold Embrace is going to keep Viper alive. All of this space for Appa, and what is Appa doing with this space? Not too much.
He's just sitting on the cover of the Silver Edge, waiting to do something with it. Now his Tempest Double walks forward, and it's only when Max and Dream get in position to beat up on him.
Razor
this is so silly. This is just so silly coming out from the side of Yakshas, honestly. Akrid dies when Roshan is up and running. He's got a 30-second respawn window, and I believe the smoke should be back online on the side of Akramaks as well, so they should be able to go contest this. That's what happens when you wait too long. When you have an opportunity and you don't make the most of it, you give your enemies more chances to capitalize on your minutest of mistakes. Taking out Razor in that fight, while Khalnayak is just running around looking for the five-man Chronosphere play to get the MVP title, it's really working against them.
Yeah, do you think the Akramaks should just pop a smoke and go because Chronosphere is on cooldown?
I think so, man. I really think Akramaks should be fighting right now. They should be going out there and looking to take a fight. Yeah, it's a 26,000 net worth deficit against them, and sure, the score is 8-21, but you're not going to get better opportunities than this. This is when your captain has to make the calls, make those risky decisions. High risk, high reward, that's the only way they're going to come back into this. But if you get Akrid in Aegis, killing him twice is an extremely tall order, especially when Khalnayak and Sand King are waiting behind him to try and make something happen in exchange. Akram's going to send the Tempest Double to keep the momentum going on the top lane as well. VP's going to go planting wards and sentries all over the map to try and get some control before the final push comes in. But now with the Aegis picked up and with the cheese on Khalnayak, they're raring and ready to go, possibly down the bottom lane where they've done some chip damage on that tier 3. Oh, Appa doesn't want any part in this though. He's gone to the top lane looking to split push.
Yeah, they can split push, and I'm not sure it's the ideal leader to send to even deal with the Arc Warden and his Tempest Double. Who do you send who can A, deal with it, and B, afford to be a bit late at the fight?
Maybe the Viper or the Winter Wyvern perhaps? Actually, the Bristleback.
The Viper.
The Bristleback.
They need the Winter Wyvern. I don't think they need the Bristleback. I think he's in the draft.
Well, Appa's Tempest Double is doing work on
this
spot.
Yeah, the tier 3 is falling. They still got Eye of the Storm. VP's prepping for the Epicenter in case they all clump up.
Okay,
the Tempest Double times out.
Hold on, I have a question here. What they just did required no Aegis. They could have done this like 15 minutes ago, 10 minutes ago. But for some reason, because they have the Aegis, they get an absurd amount of confidence and pull off a play that didn't really require it.
Top lane though, they controlled Appa, they kicked him back with the boulder smash, but have these two supports got enough to bring him down? The Magnetize is there, a negative own charge as well, and with the Kash, they bring him down. They lose the Earth Spirit in exchange. Meanwhile, Make Believe in all kinds of trouble. They surrounded him, they brought him down. Appa buys back the Winter's Curse. Well, it's just good to look at because Wasteless Void, as it had fallen, Gust. Coming up in Dream, Kalnag pops his Manda style, hopes to run. Max just falls like a sheep, and Make Believe, who's respawned or rather bought back and died back once more, has no money or no chance of coming back to try and defend his middle barracks. They're moving on to the mid lane, they pop the glaive, Max all by himself. Lanx's time walks out, Max pops his blade bane, they're stealing damage in the meantime. Heck, they're dealing damage in the meantime. The Golem Brace is going to keep him alive for a bit, but Rapper is still pounding away. The Flux is there, we've got the Spark Ring clicking in as well. The Chain Frost for good measure.
Look at this, it's, man, he hasn't even given up the Aegis. I mean, Akrid was ready to die, he doesn't give it up. Yeah, finally
gets it up. Maybe he needs to stay alive, ideally. Pops the smoke in the midst of all of that. There's the Rolling Boulder from Magnetite. They're trying to control Kanaya. Thank God he has a Ghost Scepter, and they're mighty lucky that they have nothing to dispel that. Harper sending his Tempest Trouble in like a man, and just doing a whole lot of trouble for this drill. They're going to move on to the top lane, get three sets of barracks. The Yakshas have said it. The game is done.
I mean, the Yakshas, they don't even feel like shouting about this. They've taken this game so comfortably that even they're being tame and timid about it. Yeah. Normally you'd see Punk all up in the enemy's face, screaming at them, his battle cry coming out, but all he lets out is one little quitker, and that's it.
No, he said nickel.
He said quitker, his signature.
Oh, it was quitker once more.
What an underwhelming quitker.
Ritwik Sharad 2015.